You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Joining us from the Berkshires.
Not the Berkshires.
Joining us in
Pioneer Valley.
Comedian, comedy writer, farmer, Jon Ross.
David, I have to complain.
You?
I just got off the phone with Cap Bemelman, who wanted to go over with a fine-tooth comb everything I was going to talk about, made me run all my jokes and stories past him. You got to get rid of that guy. Don't most people have, like, kids working for them as interns? How old is Cap? Is there anyone named Cap under 70?
Cappy Bemelman?
Yeah, is he an actual captain? Is he, like, does he wear the captain's hat? I'm just curious.
Cap?
The picture I have in my head. But boy, he was crazy. And all the things that I can't say on your show, told me not to say the F word. Which F word am I not allowed to say? There's more than one. I'm going to talk about the N word for a second.
Let's not come right out of the gate on that one.
I just have a prediction.
Okay.
I don't know if it's a prediction or if it's a recommendation. Because sometimes, like, stuff happens, and, you know, you go, I knew it, and, like, you didn't say it to anybody beforehand. I just want to say this beforehand. There's going to be a giant hit show, and it's going to be called, and it's going to be a hit because of its name, and it's going to be N*GGER, and it's just because it's going to be so controversial that there's a TV show called when they talk about it on the news, and, you know, they, ooh, can you say it? What do you call it? Because it's not called the N-word, like the C-word, you know, was a show on, what was that, Showtime or something?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's got to be written and produced somebody with the credentials, like that Glover kid.
Or Michael Richards, somebody who experienced with the N-word.
That may be a half hour special. That would just be video of him from the Laugh Factory.
Yeah.
I can just picture it. I can just see it. I can hear on NPR them talking about it and trying to, you know, I don't know.
I believe Penis Gregory's autobiography was called that. The comedian Penis Gregory.
was it really?
Yeah.
It's already been done.
Yes.
But, you know, it's already been done.
Google it.
It's probably, like, in my subconscious or something, and I'd seen that, and then it came back up. But, because, my God, like, look, obviously, horrible word, but, like, so powerful. Like, there's no word. The idea that you can utter a sound and it would carry that much power and weight, that it could, like, move people in so many different ways. And the idea that, like, there's some people are allowed to say it and some people aren't allowed to say it. Like, there's nothing in any language, in any culture, that's anywhere close to that, is it? It's unbelievable. It's just so... And, you know, when you watch Chappelle, did you watch Chappelle's specials?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I love him. I mean, he's amazing. But you're jealous of, like, the way he's able, it makes stuff so cool and funny, and it's like, it's, you know, look, not that he needs, you know, some kind of advantage, but it feels like an advantage when you're watching it. I mean, obviously he has all sorts of other disadvantages, but he is, you know, I'm probably getting myself in terrible hot water saying all kinds of things that I shouldn't be saying, politically incorrect, but I mean, I just watch it and he just... And the way he tosses it off, and I can't do it, you know, I can't say it right now, but it's just, like, I don't know, it's just charming and conversational, and it's like...
There is something biblical about the power of the word, you're right. It's almost as though it's from Genesis or Leviticus, where the high priests
of the first temple would be allowed in a room where only they could say the N-word. That was the power. Right?
Well, I mean, or was there a word back then? Mm-hmm. Were there words, you know, were there Latin words?
Well, in Judaism, you're not allowed to write God. It's
right,
G-D.
Right. Right.
So.
Right. Well, and then they have, and then you have all the alternative words that mean God, but that you, because you can't say the actual one. Mm-hmm. I mean, I wonder if there were people saying it and going, oh, they're allowed to say it because they're, you know, the high priest, but, you know, we can't say it. It's like, oh, they sing it in their songs. We can't.
Yeah.
So, okay. I understand a lot of your, because I know we're going to keep this short. Because you want to try to keep the show under 6 hours this week. But I understand you have a lot of your listeners are long-haul truckers.
Yes, that's correct.
Right? And,
yes.
Which makes like a ton of sense. Because
and insomniacs.
People,
and insomniacs.
Well, the insomniacs I don't maybe understand so much, but the long-haul truckers I understand because it's imperative that they not fall asleep.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they have to stay up. And, you know, it's not going to be too long before one of your guests says something, you know, mildly amusing. And you go, ha, 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 ha. And then, you know, eyes wide open.
Wakes
you're
them
awake,
up.
Man.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wakes them right up. Yeah.
Well, the problem is the insomniacs claim that I help them fall asleep.
Huh.
So I'm worried that I'm providing two services, one of which could end up confusing the long-haul trucker and resulting in a massive pileup.
Yeah. Look, I know you didn't want me to raise this, but I've been going through a little bit of a tough personal time in my life, which has caused me to not be able to sleep. I've had a lot of sleepless nights, and I have needed to, you know, go to sleep. And certain podcasts do put me to sleep, and I have not listened to yours, and yours doesn't, I have to say. I actually found, you know what I found on, like, YouTube was somebody reading, not Anna Karenina, but it was, like, another Russian novel. Like, they're reading War and Peace, and, like, I just put that on, and, you know, you don't have to go too far in War and Peace, somebody reading that to you before you're out. But then I'd wake up.
I'm operating on no sleep. Today I had an hour and a half of sleep, and then I had to be up at 5. Every conversation has started this way. What's the least amount of sleep you can function on?
Well, I think it's different for different people. I get crabby, and I'm not very good if I have less than, you know. I mean, occasionally you can go on just a few, and I've had to recently. But yeah, I mean, I like to get at least 6-7 hours.
Can you do an hour and a half?
For a day? I mean, I've had to. Like, because, like I said, I've had a few nights where I was just up all night watching television and, you know, trying to listen to stuff and rolling around and, you know, my heart pounding through my chest and thoughts.
Yeah.
So, but that's
who we are. That's who we
are. I don't want to be that. Well, here, let me say this. I'd like to talk to your listeners for a moment, if I may.
Yes.
Because a lot of times you say, what do you want my listeners to do?
Okay.
Right? That's the thing you do. I'm going to tell your listeners that they need to contact David Feldman through the David Feldman website and urge David to get on the train and come up here and stay with me on my homestead and relax. And it's quiet. And you wouldn't have hammers and jackhammers while you're trying to do a podcast. Bring your stuff. Come on up here. I have a hot tub. We can take hot tubs. No head trips. You know? But chickens, you eat fresh eggs. We'll eat right out of my garden. Come on.
I'm going to try to. I could use it. This is people listening to this show today know when I'm burnt out, and today is a burnout show.
Yeah, and you could do your podcast up here. You could recharge your batteries. And when I say that, that's a euphemism. I'll recharge your batteries.
What recharges batteries? Being around other people in nature.
I think nature. Yes, I think being with other people. What I was listening to, because I've been listening to things about loneliness and that, and it's like you need to both be supported and support. Like, you can't just, you know, I can't get on the phone and just cry my eyes out to a friend. I need to then also go, what about you? How can I, you know, tell me your problems? You need to, it needs to be sort of, a loop where you're helping each other. That's the connection. You know, making connections with people. You can come, you could cheer me on at one of my baseball games. I had a good game last night. I had three doubles and a diving play at down the line, third base, came up, threw a bullet across the diamond. It was good. And they were like the number one team in that league.
Manhattan. You lived in Manhattan.
I had an apartment, which is hilarious, that it was, did I ever, you know this, that it was, I got it from Richard Kind. Richard Kind was subletting this from somebody else, and it was illegal for him to then let somebody else. It was rent control, so it was like really, it was $158, and it was this apartment that was cut in half, and it was on 71st between Broadway and Amsterdam. So
wow.
It was an awesome location, and yeah. It was $158, but I had to forge Richard Kind's name and on a what you call it, on a money order every month, and that's how I paid it. And for people, they know who Richard Kind is. He's a character actor. He's been in 8 trillion things. Mm-hmm. But then I can't remember who took it over from me. I think it might have been Garland. I think Jeff took it over from me, and then Jon Stewart took it over from him, or vice versa. It's like, because I had that place which was rent controlled, and then I had my rent controlled place in Santa Monica, and I would go back and forth between the two. But what I sort of found was by having two homes, you have no homes, but because like you're not forced to kind of face anything. When things get tough someplace, you go, whoop, I'm going to the other coast. And
right.
You go. And then as soon as there's any kind of challenge in your life, emotionally or otherwise, you just go, see you later. I'm heading 3,000 miles the other way. And so I just never felt completely moored anywhere.
Do you think it's possible to meet a genuine person in Manhattan? Maybe Astoria, Queens. I'm talking about Manhattan.
I don't know Astoria, Queens. What is she like? like maybe you could. Yeah, that's a terrible joke.
I know. Did he say that or did I? That's so bad. That's something I would say.
I think you threw your voice.
Can you meet a nice person in Manhattan? A nice lady person in Manhattan who hasn't been effed over by herself?
Well, all right. Well, generalization. I mean, that's sort of your problem. Like, the show should be called, you know, Generalization with David Feldman. I have a question. I have a theory. All women are angry. I have a question. Do women like pickled foods? Do women like tropical fruits? Do women smoke cigarettes? You know, I don't know. Do women have good hand-eye coordination? Well, some do, some don't. Jesus Christ. You know, it's like,
Well, you're saying some do and some don't.
Some people could maybe meet somebody with a full head of hair, who was confident, who had, you know, was young and in great shape, and yeah, they could meet somebody. You couldn't. I couldn't. This is the problem. You know, we get together and we out-negative each other. So
hang on.
We could be more self-hating.
So women in general,
don't come up.
I'm not making a sweeping generalization, but most women would find me detestable. Is that a fair statement?
If they found you. you know, you are invisible to most women.
I am.
So, like, yes, you're like a stealth Jew. You could walk right up to them. You could be like a spy. They needed a spy in another country. You just walk right through and be like, you'd be invisible. No, I mean, look, I think let me say, can you meet somebody? Like, how? What are you, like, walking down the street? Some woman's going to, like, give you the eye and kind of go, hey, and you're going to go, oh, hang on a second. Why don't we step into this pub and, you know, I'll buy you a drink. Like, what do you think? Where are you going to meet? You meet people while you're doing, you know, like while you're working. I mean, you meet people on the podcast. I've heard guests seemingly who seemed into you. I'm like,
well, Cap Bemelman, that's part of the pre-interview with Cap Bemelman.
Right.
Make sure you seem like you're into David.
Mm-hmm.
That's
the good actresses.
Here's the problem. A couple of weeks ago, it was a Saturday, and I had been flat on my back with my Kindle, and a woman said to me, "That's it?" I go, "Yeah, this is it."
I heard you tell this story.
I went, "That's it." And she goes, "Really?" I go, "Yeah, this is it."
I don't want to let the cat out of the bag, David. Look, I know you like this character, it works for you, like, you know, like Jack Benny being cheap and all that. I don't want to tell your listeners the truth about oh my God. It's like you put, you know, Bill Maher and Bob Saget to shame. You're just like banging them out, you know, left, right, center.
Yeah.
You know. Oh, you're you know. Anyway.
That is not an attractive trait to think heaven is Saturday, 12 hours on a Kindle, coffee, maybe looking up from the Kindle and saying, hey, this is an interesting article.
I think that is at a certain point in a relationship. You listen to, and I do listen to your podcast and I have them all memorized. So, Susie Essman was on, who that was. Yes, I mean, you know, I listened to the last show and I didn't hear my name mentioned, and that was a little bit kind of upsetting. But
I was playing a mind game. That was a mind game.
You were playing a mind game. I thought we said no mind game. But oh no, Ed Trips. You mentioned me, and she says, I know Jon Ross, which that felt nice. But she was describing, you know, the reading in bed with her husband and then reading the paper and the two of them. And that's just heaven. I don't know, 12 hours, that might be a little much. But, you know, at their point in their relationship, they love, you know, lying in bed. Now, look, if this is the second date, you want to lie on the couch and read for 12. Somebody might go, yeah, you know, I don't know if this is like we're forming a bond. You know what I mean? I get that. Like, there's a time and a place.
So dating is a lie. Dating is the first lie of a relationship.
You know, no, it's a phase. It's a phase of the relationship. I mean, there are, but yes, I mean, look, my wife and I'm getting a divorce just like you, except it's different. But, you know, and one of the things that she says is, like, it was different early on. Like, I seem to be more up for doing more different things. Mm-hmm. And now I'm not as interested in going on, you know, a silent meditation retreat.
She wanted to go on a silent meditation retreat.
She didn't. I used that. Actually, I actually want to go on one now to try to find myself.
Oh, so she didn't want to go on a silent meditation.
No, I pulled that out because I didn't know what else to say. But, like, just different things that,
now,
you know.
I remember when my third wife approached me. And she said, I think we'd have fun on a silent meditation retreat. Retreat?
Mm-hmm.
Retreat? And I said, you know, I'm not sure I would enjoy it. Why don't we test it out by you shutting the fuck up for 6 hours?
It gets so, everybody goes, it's like, David's going to do a joke here. It's like, hey, back up. Here it comes. It's like the cadence has slowed down.
Have you heard the roundtables where I actually do that?
No.
Where I actually say, I've got a joke, here we go.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
All right. This is great. This is fantastic.
All right, before we go, I want you to do the thing. I want you to do the thing that you did with Larry Brown, where you just said, you know, names of airline disasters or the date. And I guess,
okay,
because I can't do any worse than him. He didn't get any, so I won't get any either. because I don't know anything about that, but I'm just saying, that was hilarious. You just kept naming these. I don't know that one.
I don't know what happened. Well, first of all, Larry Brown has a semi-photographic memory for plane accidents. Yes. And if you go back a year...
For other things, too. He's an odd cat.
Yeah. And if you go back a year, he was like hitting them out of the park. And then for some reason, he clammed up.
It was actually a hilarious bit that like one after the other, and he kept kind of going, oh, is it this one? And it's like, no, that was not that. And then he was like, no, but I only do like the big ones, not like the little commuter planes. And then you ask him some big one, he's like, no, I don't know that either.
November 5th.
It was hilarious.
November 5th, 1973.
That's my birthday.
Is it really?
November 5th, not 70.
Is November 5th your birthday?
It is, yeah.
And then you said you noticed something that I do with my guests.
What?
You said you noticed that there's something that I do at the end of some interviews.
Oh, yes. Yeah. So that made me laugh. The idea that, like, the Johnny Carson, it used to be the seal of approval that you would get. It's like, did you get the okay sign? And every comic would watch at the end of their set. We'd all be, you know, watching them, and then they'd pan over to Johnny, and sometimes Johnny would just be clapping, and you go, oh, he didn't get the okay sign, he's not coming back. But then they get the okay, and you go, oh, man, Johnny, gave me the okay sign. Well, the new version of that is David saying, stay on the line a minute. Because if David says, so thanks so much. I know your time's valuable. You've been very generous. Great talking to you. All right. Goodbye. Hey, can you stand the line a minute? And then, oh, you got to stand the line a minute. He's a friend of David. Ooh.
Well, all right. So, stay on the line. Can you stay on the line for a second?
I'm not staying on the line.
When you said that, I laughed so hard because it has occurred to me that that's how it comes across, like as though people are hanging on my interviews, whether or not I like the guest. The reason I do that is sometimes I'm recording the interview and sometimes somebody else.
And sometimes you just need to say the N-word.
The what?
The N-word. And you have to wait to get off the air so you can say the N-word to them. That's so sick. You say, hang on, stay on a second. Wait, we're not. Okay. We just have this, like, Tourette's syndrome. Oh my god.
It's so funny. The idea that this, you know, I have the radio shows on Pacific, it's this far, far left wing radio show. Can you stay on the line? I have to tell you something.
it's just a string of obscenity and horrible racist, awful misogynistic things that you say just because it's all pent up because you're so tight. Oh my god.
Now you really do have to stay on the line. I mean, like, I'm just talking to the mic.
That'd be like any of your phone calls to me, though.
It would be like, I'm saying the N-word, the C-word, just over and over. And the guest is going, uh-huh. I see.
And now I'm going to pay you. I'm going to pay you a compliment, a wonderful compliment. and that is, like, you do spew some of the worst, horrible jokes, like just so bad. But on the other hand, you have some of the greatest jokes of all time. Like, I would, you know, there's so many of the great jokes of yours that I would quote. And one of them, I haven't heard you do in forever, though I haven't seen your act quite, but the one about how horrible the C word is. And you would never say the C word. You wouldn't even go to Sea World.
Right.
Remember that?
Yes. I hate the C word. In fact, I hate it so much I won't even go to Sea World.
Yeah,
I don't know what they have there. I won't even imagine. It's got And then the women, the horrible tag. Do you remember the horrible tag?
No, I don't.
Well, the women would get really pissed off. And I go, what? It's SeaWorld. It's got to be.
Why would they get pissed off? It's, you know, I can't understand. Why would someone be angry at that? Am I stupid?
Well, they get pissed off from my stupidity. And then I tagged it with, you know, the SeaWorld near Busch Gardens.
Oh,
good night, everybody. Okay. That would be.
That's sort of a dumb pun. But I mean, to me, to say, look, I hate the SeaWorld. That's a chance to say something serious, sort of. Like, look, I think that's a bad thing and people shouldn't say it. And maybe it would have helped you if you went on a little bit and actually kind of made a point that I think the meaning and blah, blah, blah. And I hate it so much, I won't even go to SeaWorld. And then it's just a joke. Mm-hmm. But how is that, like, mean to anybody?
They think
you're mocking.
I think there's a place in Orlando with angry women with short haircuts and grumpy cat faces. That's what they think I'm imagining.
Jumping out of the water to eat fish.
Did a set two nights ago, and this is kind of interesting. You have to imagine how wide my grin was when this comic was telling me this, and then I'll let you go. But stay on the line.
I will gird my loins. Yeah, go ahead.
So I'm talking to this really good-looking young. I think he was gay.
Mm-hmm.
He was Asian and African. Mm-hmm. He was Asian and African American. So
beautiful.
So when his girlfriend asked for 69, he says, "I don't know."
I'm gay.
I can't. I'm trying to do a beef and broccoli. I keep doing variations on the beef. I know.
Right. Something. I can only do the beef part.
And he starts complaining to me about how politically correct college audiences are.
Well, and is he a comedian or is he just
he's a comedian.
Person?
He's a comedian.
Oh.
He's in his late 20s. He's gay. Mm-hmm. He's Asian. He's African American, and he's complaining about the audiences and how the PC police are giving him a hard time. And I just looked at him and I said, "Go on."
Uh-huh.
And he was, and I thought, "Well, this is delicious."
Well, I will say this, and look, I don't know this guy because I don't know who he is, and I know you've sort of switched positions on the whole identity comedy thing. You used to be like, "Don't do that," just, you know. Don't rely your whole act on like who you are.
Mm-hmm.
But if you do, and now you're like, okay, that's cool. Go ahead and do it. But if you do it and you're not good, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like, if you're not really that smart and clever and funny, but you're relying on a lot of these stereotypes, which I did think there were. I remember acts who used to do that,
mm-hmm.
who, you know, and they got away with it because they were, like, this guy can make black jokes and Asian jokes and get away with it, but if they're not good and they're just the stereotypes, I get that people might be, hey, you suck. Don't do that. You know what I mean? So I don't know. It could be an individual case of, yeah, you deserve to be getting booed. But, man, the stuff I hear, I haven't worked in colleges in a million years, and so I don't know, but some of the stuff you hear about the safe spaces and stuff, forget about comedy, just like any kind of dialogue on colleges is sounding like it's being, you know, shut down. It's weird.
Did you ever see The Triumph? Did you ever see Triumph talking to...
Which one?
The one where he goes up to Hampshire College and talks to the kids about safe spaces?
No.
Oh, Google.
Is that on, like... Oh, okay. No, Hampshire's right up here.
Oh, it was great. It was great. We did it last year. It's amazing. Hey, stay on the line.
For real?
Yes.
I'm just imagining you, like, you going, like, to Corey Bretschneider, just like... just spewing just filth.
This entire episode played.
Has been brought to you.
Oh, that's the other thing before you go. We'll finish on that one in a second.
Okay.
This entire episode, if it were played for any potential guests like Corey Bretschneider, I don't want to be a part of this. This is like this every.
I have to recuse myself from the David Feldman show.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many. There's nothing socially redeemable about this episode.
I'm glad I could be a part of it.
You made me laugh so hard. What was the thing, like me delivering a funeral oration? It's like they asked me to speak at somebody's funeral. What would it go?
Yeah, I can't remember. I can't remember exactly. There's just something about, you know, people being bereaved and it's a hard time and that there, you know, there are no words that I can really say. But I think that if you were to do your Amazon shopping through the David Feldman website, you know, look, we get a small part. How can that be bad? I don't know. I can't remember exactly. What did I say?
Oh, it got to the point where I'm like, oh, baby, baby. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. We get a small percentage of everything you buy.
I'm so funny. I forget the things that I say.
You have me. You have me. Mr. Feldman, we have some horrible news. Your grandmother was... It's the home. Your grandmother in her sleep. Oh, that's terrible. That's at least she did her Amazon shopping.
No, I think the other one was like I was having a really hard time, and you were calling me and trying to, you know, make me feel better. And you said, you know, there's one of the episodes. somebody talks about this, and it's. I think if you listen to this episode, it'll really resonate with you. But it's part of the premium content. Like you have to subscribe to hear it. So,
I wish I could give you the password, but my hands are tied.
Alex doesn't even tell me. I don't know what the password.
Oh, the other one was you were saying we're talking about a comic, and you said, "Is he a good guy?" And I said, "Yeah, he does his Amazon shopping via the Dave Show." As though that's code for being a good guy. Yeah, he's a good guy. Does his Amazon shop. All right, Jon Ross, this was great. I love you, man.
I love you. I mean, seriously. I love you. Hi.
You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.